With us in studio, he's going to be at the Orlando Improv. Two shows tonight, two shows tomorrow, one show on Sunday.
We call that the standard. That's the 2-2-1.
Yes, Pablo Francisco's here. How you doing, Pablo?
Good. How are you? Good morning.
Good morning. You're in good hands. That's
good
right.
Good to see you, man.
Yeah, it's good to see you, too. You guys are nice and tan.
Been a minute. We have to be tan because we're
welcome
fat.
Welcome to Florida.
Yeah, if you're going to be fat, you have to be tan. A wise man once said that to me.
There you go.
Also sitting on the couch, Myverse, so you may know her from Wildin' Out.
Yes. Well, wait, not yet. They only aired one episode.
What? Oh, okay. Well,
but I'm filming, they haven't aired that new season, and I'm filming in May.
Congratulations.
Cool.
That's awesome.
Thank you so much.
I will say right now that I'm not a massive Wildin' Out fan, but when I catch it, I really enjoy it. And then I will say this. The people that we have come in here that tour from Wildin' Out are some of the nicest human beings.
Absolutely.
Whether it's Chico Bean, whether it's... Carlos,
DC Young Fly,
those guys. When they come in here, they're the most respectful. They give us like life lessons, and they're like inspirational,
super humble.
Chico put us on a tour. Like when he left, we were like, we've got the next 5 years planned out of our lives.
We are organized.
I feel better about being a father.
Absolutely,
I look in the mirror and I like the person I see. Like those guys, I don't know what it is, and I don't know if that's that Nick Cannon effect.
It's an energy, and it's just the way that I think Nick Cannon knows how to pick the people, because that's why I'm there. I'm feeling myself.
We have Pablo, who the last time we talked to you, we asked you worst gig, and you can tell me if I'm wrong. Didn't you have a stage sink into mud, and then you were attacked by bees?
Bees. Oh, that's when I did that brain surgeon's show, and where they go, and the guy tells me, he goes, we're really religious, so don't talk about sodas, dancing. I was like, what?
Sodas.
Yeah. So I go, all right. So I was on stage, and this bee comes, and this is my favorite story, by the way.
I'm so glad that you remember this.
Yeah, and this bee's like, I'm trying to do my first joke. Hey, what's going on? He's doing like Casey. I'm Casey Casey, man. And all of a sudden, this bee's like, and the whole show is me just trying to get away from this bee, and then the stage collapsed.
And then
it was like 35 minutes went by, but it kept on coming back.
You're still my winner of muddy stage sinking and bee attack.
Yeah,
it's the best.
Yeah, because you figure when you go to a pool, like when you're around a pool and that bee comes around, you're like, what's going on with the wasp? Bee. and things like dodging it, but it was great. Yeah. Just sinking stage and big old one of those big bees too, man. You know, the ones that have nuts on it.
So Pablo, what's been going on, man? You just been torn?
I've been torn. Just working on this new album. It's called Here We Go Again, and it's basically gonna make me making fun of everybody. And Mark Wahlberg's in every movie. That's right. He's in Star Wars. The Force is with you, but you're not a Jedi yet. Huh? Darth Vader? You're my father? I don't think so. You're doing good. You know, that kind of thing, because he's everywhere now.
That's a fantastic Wahlberg, man.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
We have a Wahlbergers here now.
Do they really?
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, my
I think
God.
It closed, right?
We should go eat there after.
Did it close?
And then have him do...
I don't think it's closed. I think it's still open.
Oh. Okay. I mean, I'm thinking of Fatone's hot dog place.
Yeah, Fat Ones.
That'd be a really good promo.
Joey Fatone did a hot dog place, and then... We have a Wahlburgers. Do we have any other famous restaurants here?
The Fatone hot dog, the
fat
ones, that closed.
Yes, it did.
Fast. Like 1 year. Like,
hot dogs? Really? He didn't even sell 1 year of hot. They were crazy hot dogs. They split them down the middle.
Whoa.
And then they flat grilled them, And then he put all the crazy toppings on it. Like, this one's zany. It's got a pickle and crushed up potato chips on it.
Yeah. What was the guy?
Yago.
Yeah, and then sometimes they go, well, you just cut it there and put some spices in there. And we get little ladies in there.
That's exactly what it was.
Creepy hot dogs.
Creepy hot dogs would have been a better name.
What are they made of? But you know what? I'm having a new sex toy coming out here instead of hot dogs and stuff like that. It's called Arnold's Butt Plugs. It's incredible. It's a beautiful thing.
Toys for twats.
I want to ask you, you said you're filming a special coming up soon,
right?
But on what platform? Because I've been asking all the comedians that come in here, what's there's so many different ways and avenues and distribution of content, and it seems unlimited now. Like, you could do it yourself. You can go through Hulu, Netflix, iTunes,
Hulu,
Amazon,
YouTube, Amazon, Showtime. But all of those, then there are the guys that just do it on their own. They're just fuck it, I'm going to put it out.
Right.
And it's mine, and you know, it's going to be a lot of work, but at least I'll just reap promote all the
it
benefit.
And sell it myself. And then there, you can go through the services. Like, we're about to, we're working with like Amazon Prime just to release our documentary for Rent. Like, there's like tons of ways that you could like release content now. And then, like, how do you even choose the right one?
Yeah, you know, the thing is, my manager, he's shooting for Netflix, you know, and he's he runs Levity Entertainment. He runs like Iron Chef and those kind of shows. So basically, we're going to film it up in Las Vegas, which is great because, you know, it's you can just talk about anything about there, but basically the format is it's like Dave Chappelle meets In Living Color divided by the square root of Family Guy, that kind of thing, because we're gonna put cartoons in it too, so it'd be like,
oh, that'll,
you know,
be cool.
Yeah, it's like Dog the Bounty Hunter. He's a convicted felon but doesn't have the right to vote, but has every right to come to your house and spray mace in your face, that kind of thing. And then we show Dog the Bounty Hunter, and he looks like a Barbie doll thrown in a dryer. But we're shooting for, like, you know, Netflix, and Comedy Central is always interested too, so we're gonna filming out and just feel out and see where we stand.
Is Netflix the leader for putting out like comedy specials right now? Is, like, because they just have done so much of, like, people gravitate towards Netflix when they're looking for specials?
Yeah, after they did Dave Chappelle and now they're doing Amy Schumer and stuff like that. All these comedians are getting big deals out of it. So just to be part of that would be great. But I'm not going to keep my hopes up too high. But I'm I'll shoot for
petition
it.
Petition for it.
Well, yeah, and not to, like, obviously I'm not going to ask you what, like, kind of money Netflix pays, but I heard that it's kind of all over the place. And is there a standard, like, once they buy your special, is there like a standard fee, or is it like person to person? Like, you every deal is different.
That money part is kind of odd, because I mean, like, my last special, I invested like $70,000 into it,
and huge production.
And Comedy Central and Image, they put like $170,000 into it too. So, and then when you get the monies, it kind of gets distributed through, you know, getting hits on YouTube, and not YouTube, but people buy through YouTube, and then it goes through all that kind of stuff, like Amazon and stuff. So that money part is, it's a little tricky for me, so I can't really
of course, I just wondered if there was like a standard of, like, okay, if Netflix buys your special, like, everybody gets the same, because who was there was some comedian that was like talking shit.
Monique.
Oh, it was Monique. Yeah.
Monique that was talking about the amount of money. You know,
she was
the,
like,
difference.
Saying,
yeah.
She goes, Amy Schumer's getting, she's getting $13 million if you offer me. You know,
that's pretty good.
Yeah, who's that person?
Sassy.
I'm an Oscar winner. $500,000. What's up? That's witchcraft. That's Illuminati.
And Pablo, do you think, like, I've always, I've been saying this lately, I'm like, there's so much content out now compared to what, like, even 10 years ago, 20 years ago. Right. It's just like, just every infinity. Like, hey, I want to watch a comedy special. Like, you know, 20 years ago, it was like, you had access to five, maybe, you know, and like, and maybe HBO had some, or like, you know,
Showtime.
Even comedy Showtime and stuff. And you could pretty much, you know, have access to maybe 20 if, like, and maybe through rental or something.
Right.
Like, now it's hundreds. Like, I don't even know, like, an infinite amount you could watch.
It's,
I mean,
too
just
many
on Netflix.
Like, people release, like, comedians that I follow release so, there's so many out there, I don't have enough time to watch the specials. It used to be that the specials came out and kind of fit my schedule. Like,
every couple of years,
I'd be like, oh, great, a new, you know, Louis special. And then I'd go and watch it. I mean, of course, I won't be doing that, you know, at least for a little while until he makes his way back up. I'm sure it'll happen.
And back old school, like, you know, you talk to old school comedians, they tell us, you know, it used to take like 7 years before they'd come out with their out, like a long time, hone that special. And now they're coming like, pop, like, you know, people are doing once an hour special once a year,
right? And sometimes the quality, you can tell it's, if it's okay. The ones that we do, we make sure it's a three camera shoot, we make sure it's quality and stuff, because a lot of comedians go, man, did you see my eighth special? It's me on a mountain. It's like, visiting kids and doing comedy.
It with my phone.
It's the wacky comedy starring this comedian that does jokes and he rehashes his jokes, and they did it over here, then he's in China, then he's in Tokyo. he's a heavy metal band. It's like, I remember it would fit my schedule too, you know. People like, after, like, on a Saturday night, late night, at midnight, we have an HBO 1 hour thing that would come on ABC or something
But
it would, with the promotions, I know there are so many networks out there on the Butt Plug Network or whatever. I subscribe to that.
Everybody has
a
network.
It's one of the only ones I subscribe to.
AT&T's coming out with one.
Disney Plus is coming out soon.
Apple.
It's like, streaming. Everybody wants an app. Yeah, you know, it's
Apple
all streaming.
Apple 3 TV comedy.
And then now, like, and then of like with Disney wanting like a subscription, like an AT&T, and all the, there's going to be a time where you're going to like, all right, I have a
ESPN's doing it
15,
too.
15, like 20 different places I can get a like they're a $6 subscription, $10. You're paying more than cable.
Like I used to be able to watch all the MLS soccer matches. I can't anymore because you know ESPN. They're like, oh, we put those on ESPN Plus, but you know, and then they chip away at it. It's like, oh, it's $2 extra.
Yeah,
like,
for Plus. Yeah,
well, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
You know?
So I mean, ESPN like, Plus, and then you have to pay more for. Then you have to. They have a TV show too, following that Plus.
The NFL Network. And you pay. Yeah, you know, and then
you
like
pay
the,
extra
all
for that.
So what do you guys think? I'm curious of like what like you know because now people are consuming entertainment totally different and like. You know, teenagers and people in the early 20s, in my verse, you could tell me about, like, it seems like no one even knows, like, younger kids don't know what cable, they're not scrolling through the channels, like, they have no idea. Right. There's, like, you know, YouTube, Netflix,
no,
Hulu.
They're just being told what to watch, like, it's like, or whatever's viral, you know what I mean? So that's, everything's at your disposal, you know?
Although I'm starting to see a little bit of what you're saying with my daughter. Like, if she goes to Disney Junior, there's so many fucking choices that she'll go big block things. No, Fancy Nancy. No.
Yeah.
And then so she's starting to do what we do, which is waste time in the
scrolling through.
And I'm like,
finding
this,
what's trending.
And then I start to like have anxiety. I'm like, this is fucking bad. I need to just like put on something and be like, sorry, that's all. Like, because Andrea, my wife, is really good at that. She'll just put something on. Like yesterday, Puppy Dog Pals is on. That's Harlan's Harlan Williams show. And my daughter likes it, but she wanted something else. And my wife's like, no, that's what's on. That's all we got.
That's a good idea. That's,
you know, hey, that's it.
That's all you got.
Yeah. It's funny because like too many options, like human beings, like psychologically don't like to be given infinite options, right?
Yeah, because we don't know what to choose from.
I end up watching nothing. Like even last night, I'm going through the I'm doing the scroll. And I was like, ah, fuck it. And I just turned it off.
I'll just watch the same thing.
I'll just listen to music, you know, or listen to a podcast or something.
I think a good idea for me right now is getting my attention is that, like, when I go to YouTube to watch, you know, maybe, like I was all interested in space landing and stuff like that. They'll have a movie on the side that you can get for $2.99. That's what gets me. That's what pulls me in. So if I watch something from Richard Pryor highlights on YouTube, and they'll go, hey, here and now.
They're recommending something.
Yeah, and it's like $1.99. It's really cheap, and it downloads right into your
I'll just Google, like, comedy. Like, what comedy is out? And then I'll look at the trailer and then.
Are you a movie person?
Like I am. I love movie. I love film. I love all of that.
I'm a sick person because I think I watch more pornography.
About it.
I think I watch more pornography. I was actually thinking about this. I wasn't planning on talking about it, but fuck it, I don't care.
Well, we were talking about
it. I figured you would be. And I was like, I think I watch more of. I know all the characters. And he gets mad at me because I'll be like, yeah, that's what's her name. And he'll be like, how do you know that? I'm like, I don't know.
I went on Twitter.
I wanted to see, you know, what her dog looks like.
They're acting.
That's what it is. Oh, yeah.
You know, it is weird nowadays where you could literally, you find the porn star, you go and see their family life. Like, you see them on social media.
Yeah, it's weird.
Like, I feel like, weird seeing them kiss their kids.
I don't even want to know they're like, oh my God, you're a mom.
Like, I don't want to bust out who this girl is, but she used to be a porn star, but she's not a porn star anymore. And she popped up in my timeline, and it was a picture of her in Vegas standing on like a balcony of some hotel, like the Palms or something.
Right. And
she's holding, she's dressed in like an evening gown. I guess she's going out. And she's holding her baby son, and he's pulling her titty out.
Ouch.
He's like pulling her dress down, and I'm like, I don't know about that.
I don't know if I should like this.
I was like, before.
She put it on.
I feel like this is like.
I was like, before I knew you, I would look at you nude, but now your son is like offering your titties to me. I'm like, I don't know. Like, this is fucking.
That's how she's.
further than even porno. Like, this is going to fuck me up with my wife somehow.
Wow. Good God.
That's how she's finding her next husband.
Yeah, I don't know how. I was like, even right now, I'm like, I'm a little mixed up.
And her husband's probably going, man, she's cheating on me. I think she's cheating.
Yeah, and the kid's like chilling. He's like all in like Gap clothing, and he's just got his hand on her dress, and he's just like, bonk. You know, he's like pulling it out. Yeah, there it is.
On my verse, I want to ask you how you find your way on Wildin' Out. Like, what was the audition process like? What was how did you progress to the show?
I started off as I was a poet who became a rapper who became a battle rapper who is now finding her way into comedy. So battle rap is where I got my notoriety.
Weird
because that's where Tom got his notoriety.
I don't know if you can tell.
My guy.
In the battle rap, I had a splashing water in my face. Yeah. I'm like, got one chance, a rusty mirror.
Mom's vegetarian spaghetti.
Mom's spaghetti.
Well, his wife's a vegetarian. So.
But
no meat in there.
I'm interested in the battle rap world. Like, what?
Oh, it gives me anxiety when I watch those videos. Everything gives me anxiety.
Well, you're gonna punch him in the face.
Yeah, it's scary.
Yeah,
I'm gonna get hurt, but I'm just like, don't make me look like a fool.
Right. Where do they even do like the big battle rap competition? Like, because I'm sure how do you work your way up to be qualified for the big? Like, is there a
son? Welcome to the cypher.
Yeah. Run that.
Is there competitions that you win to be able to get on a bigger stage and the battle rap community?
Well, I was very strategic when I got into battle rap. My first battle, nobody knew who I was, so I just battled some random girl. And then Queen of the Ring, they're an all-female battle rap league. They found me. And
I bet the girls go way harder than the guys do.
Yeah, they probably talk about
You know what? They actually do. They talk about dead babies, all that.
Oh my god.
Dead babies and small weenies.
Definitely. It's crazy. Like some of the stuff that I'm like, I don't know, you know? Is there any honor?
Do you research
my name in your mouth, please do not disparage. I remember when your mother had a fucking miscarriage.
What your dad can do with a carrot.
Like, don't talk about it.
They couldn't stop the bleeding and she died. And your grandma's got AIDS.
You would have bodied somebody. They would have loved you.
Yeah, why did you say that?
Your grandma's AIDS.
They would have been like, man, this guy's top five.
Hold on, have we reached the point where your grandma could have AIDS at this point?
Oh, yeah.
Because
that's the category of porn I was going to tell you. AIDS grannies.
Because Magic Johnson's alive. He could be a grandfather. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, we've had...
He's special AIDS.
We're there.
When you're a roadhog, you can get AIDS. You get to the beach.
But it started off with Queen of the Ring, and then from Queen of the Ring... you know, my name was kind of, you know, bubbling.
Yeah.
So like, Smack URL, they're like, I don't know if you know about Smack DVDs. Like, this is like,
what is it? Tell me.
It's part of the culture. Like, it's where they would have DVDs and they would show artists, but from time to time they would have people battle rap each other.
Okay.
And so it went from DVDs to YouTube, and so now that was their league. And so from there, I was, you know, one of the first females to like probably have one of the best battles on their channel.
That's really? Awesome. So you like it's
first Latino Puerto Rican to be on there.
It went viral, like on YouTube.
I wouldn't say it went viral, but I mean, it got the attention of Wildin' Out. You know what I mean?
And the battle rap community.
In the battle rap community, absolutely.
I was always curious, like when you go up to battle someone, you're battle rapping someone. Do you research that person, or are you just meeting them for the first time there and having to go?
Well,
like,
that's a different era. That was the era of freestyle where you could see, you know, you would battle 16 people in one day. You know what I mean? And now it's where, you know, you have your opponent and then you prepare. It's like a roast. It's literally, if you're watching Comedy Central roast, it's just like that, but you have three rounds against that person. And it's up to you if you want to go personal and talk about, you know what I mean? Whatever. I'm more of the humorous type. I like humor and I like
take it lighthearted.
Punchline. I'm not lighthearted, but you know, I'm really about, I like the comedic side of it. And
Is it like a roast? Is it like anything goes?
Anything. I tell you, we talk about dead babies. Anything goes. They don't, there's no
holding back at all. Like, no. There's no like, hey, don't go there, like at all.
Some,
like,
some people will put that in their contract. Like, they'll be like, you know, you can't talk about this, you can't talk about that. You know?
Really? Yeah. Okay. Wow.
Some people will, because some people have had family members that pass, and there's been people that violate that. And it's like,
oh my God.
Yeah. It's like, I would punch somebody in the face.
Yeah.
I would punch you in the face. You want to get punched in the face because you wouldn't say that to me in real life.
Yeah.
And so to me, my thing is like, I like a good roast. I like roasting. I think that's, and that's what battle rap was. And now it's just more like, now it's better. It's getting back to that. You know what I mean? Because as of recent, there's been some battle rappers that have passed that, you know, it kind of makes you, you know, it's a legacy that you're going to leave.
I'm curious, like, is it always crap? Like, who determines the winner? Is it?
It used to be judged, but now it's like, you know, it's really the people online. It's, you know what I mean? It's the people online. Sometimes they'll have polls and sometimes they'll have, you know what I mean? Like, you'll hear the crowd be like, 3-0, 3-0.
Gotcha.
But sometimes they troll. Sometimes it's like home team advantage.
I was going to ask you about, like, because anytime you have a crowd involved or whatever, it becomes super subjective. And right. Pablo, understand. Like, we used to in radio days host a lot of bikini contests.
Right.
You'll see where I'm going with this, right? But and a lot of the bikini contests,
it is what it is. It's a little bit of money.
Every once in a while, like, especially when you had like not the ringers, it became where just ringers, where the circuit girls would just come and like make money doing this.
Right.
But back earlier, like early 2000s, like you would get people from the crowd or whatever. And every once in a while,
it was more organic then.
Yeah.
Yes. Right. Like, and there was no camera.
And every once in a while,
that's why. Yeah. People don't do that stuff anymore.
The drunk big girl would get up there and
she would rule it.
And she would, you know, like the other
girls are just getting water in their tits and doing like a
little
wet
junk in the trunk.
You know? The bigger girl will literally go too far. She's putting a super soaker in her asshole.
Oh gosh.
And people are like, go.
But,
there was a mother and a daughter. Remember at Club La Vila when I did that?
No,
a mother and a daughter got up there and got nude and started like 69ing. And I'm like, that's your child, man. And she's like, I just had a baby.
I'm sorry, breastfeeding.
It's just like, but
they did worse than that.
When the big girl got up there, it would be like a bunch of circuit girls that were like professionals, and then the big drunk girl from the crowd, and she'd win the $800 prize money, and the rest of the girls would be pissed. And obviously, the sanctity of the bikini contest was thrown off by the crowd. And I always like when he's
for her being nasty like that. I mean, that's where the big crowd laughs. It should have been a nice bikini ass, but instead she took the super soaker.
It wasn't necessarily nasty. It was just like perfect ten. They're not doing anything, and then we get a 3 who's going fucking nuts.
right, okay.
And you go, you know what? I'm gonna vote for you because you're having fun. The other girls, I can tell, are assholes.
Yeah, right.
So my question to you is: have you ever been involved in a battle rap and you've been better, like lyrically better, or whatever, or seen someone who is more talented lyrically? They're better. They've put together the rap better, skilled or whatever. But the other person may have a gimmick or just be louder and stuff, and then get the crowd behind them and they win an unfair one.
Yeah, no, I think the thing is with battle rap, it plays out way different in the room than on camera.
Okay.
Sometimes people win in the room, and then when you actually see the footage, they won. You know what I mean? Like, you actually hear the punchlines and you hear the bars and the metaphors.
Oh, right.
I've battled this one girl amazing 3 rounds. I'm like, oh my gosh, I should just reuse this shit because this bitch was whack. So I'm sorry. Can I?
You can curse as much as you want.
I can
say everything you want. Yeah.
Great. Awesome. So
everybody can just relax now.
Shit, yeah. So this girl, she in her rounds, while I'm rapping, she kept changing her clothes. And then like, and it takes away from your performance.
She was like distracting.
She was trying to distract the crowd and stuff. And so I obviously, with the talent of freestyling, I rebutted what she was doing at that point. Right. And then I'm just like, you're setting yourself up. So like, you want to keep doing this, you know what I mean?
Got that.
But there was like great content and the crowd was just they just didn't catch it.
They just didn't catch it. I can imagine it frustrating people.
Like, you're just not catching me, man.
Yeah, like, you don't get
I'm
it?
Giving it at you.
Too cerebral.
You're not picking it up.
Yeah. Sometimes you rap too quick. What's going on? Can I get that verb in there? That predicate? Yeah.
Like, what did you just say?
Pablo, I think last time you were in here, I meant to ask you, like, who your favorite impressionist of all time like is, or who like kind of inspired you growing up.
You know, it was my neighbors. I had these neighbors that would make fun of my parents, and I'd make fun of their parents and stuff like that. And it was these, like, these Mexican kids, man. They were so hilarious. They would just make fun of my mom and make fun of my dad. And so I'd go after their mom, but their mom didn't talk a lot, so I couldn't have to go after their brothers and stuff like that. Mm. So, but after a while, man, it was just basically just, you know, watching television and watching, you know, they had this Muppet Show kind of commercial. With Kermit the Frog. Hi, it's Kermit. Once I got that, started using that and just taking the tape recorder, it just kind of snowballed from there. So it's like, you know, the Kermit the Frogs turn into a boss guy, you know, and then it turns into Danny Glover. And that kind of thing. And
was it just you practicing over and over? And did you bounce it off anybody, or did you know you got it right when you were doing it?
It was like that tape recorder, that little, you know, that play button and the red button. When I would just do that and play to, you know, for my friends and my cousins got into it. And after that, it took off from there, just having fun like that. But
do you try to attack a new person, like, as far as like I want to get this guy's voice down every year,
right,
or month, or do you set a goal, or is it just you just wait for the inspiration to hit?
The inspiration to hit sometimes. Sometimes, you know, you got the MyPillow guy. Everyone's talking about that guy, but I can't get him down. But it's like the Allstate guy was fun to do. Are you in good hands? Do Decepticons and Transformers usually become a liability with Allstate? And Michael, I know everyone does a Michael J. Fox, but I just like, you know, and it's kind of a old kind of impersonation, but I just like, you know, Doc, come on, that kind of thing. And then you got the Chris Rock, what's the deal? But it's really hard to try to find new ones, you know, like Mark Wahlberg's a little bit different. Well, he's kind of new, but
I like the Wahlberg.
So there you go. You do it good? So it's like the heavy breathing.
Oh my God,
stuff.
Can we go to Wahlburger and you order a burger with that voice?
We have a drive through? No.
I'm sure they've never got that before.
That would be
the employees are miserable. They're like, God, out of all the burger places I could be working at.
Extra cheese?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hey man, you want extra cheese? Huh? You doing good? Is it good? Pop, but that's like, it. Yeah.
I'm sure you do a lot of voiceover work, and I wonder.
Oh, you have a shit fly attacking your
face. I know.
Face right
yeah,
now.
Why is that? Butler spilled the vinegar.
Yeah.
And Butler, put the vinegar out for the shit flies.
Yeah, yeah, man.
That's how you know you're in a good studio.
Yeah. The vinegar smell?
Yeah.
It's shit.
Well, we put we have to keep the shit flies away from the actual studio.
Is there still like a lot of voiceover work out there? Like, I remember it being like Daniel. Remember there was like a bunch of in radio, at least like early 2000s. There was like, if you were in radio, you should apply to.
Oh, I did a bunch of stuff
to right. Like this company that was looking. Constantly
yeah, they would
for
look for like
radio.
They're like, we just need a younger voice of a guy that can just read well. And I'm right. Like, I'm your guy. And I did like 7 episodes of some travel show like in Poland.
Right, right.
Know? But they just needed a guy to be like, hey, this is Orlando, and just talk like me. And I'm like, this is the easiest gig I've ever had. And they're just throwing money
and
at me.
And then certain
right, absolutely
corporate,
do
you know,
that,
and I'm sure you get a ton of that because you're so versatile with your voice.
Yeah, I get some of that. You know, usually when I was with Don LaFontaine, you know, he was like, he goes, you know what? I'm going to put you with my, he put me with his little special crew of guys up in New York.
Yeah.
And then he passed away. But, you know, when I got there, you know, and I was doing Howard Stern at the time, too, when I got there, it was funny, but you've seen those guys you see here on TV, like, you know, Hercules and all your favorite Disney characters. And you meet
so
with those
good.
Dudes. And it's kind of cool because, like I did these commercials for Subaru just recently, and these guys are from Australia, and they go, you don't even have to audition, man. You know, just come on over.
They're one of our sponsors, yeah. Subaru. We love the Subarus.
Yeah, it was a Subaru SV, and I just went in there. And when, you know, the guys have the scripts, you jump in there and get them with them, and, you know, say, yeah, I got some ideas, and you can have them if you want them. And it worked out real well. But
do you remember it?
It's a Subaru SV. That's right. Now you see it. Now you don't. That kind of thing.
Yeah.
Dude, and there's like, people don't realize there's a lot of money in just voice.
Yeah.
Like, I think people got the hint when they heard about.
I mean, that guy before he passed was I mean, he had his little studio in his house, right?
And yeah, and he's just like, yeah, he goes, come on, let's do some voiceover. I do three of these a day. I live like a king. And yeah. I was like, oh, yeah. Wow. And he just
did. Amazing.
He did.
I remember, when Gilbert Gottfried lost his Aflac job.
Right.
And that was big news. But I think the bigger shock to everybody was how much money he was getting paid just to do the Aflac duck voice. The duck voice.
So, wait, he was the one that was going Aflac.
Yes.
Yeah. And then they hired some normal guy.
After the Japanese tsunami, Gilbert Gottfried went on Twitter and made a joke about like, hey, they should we should ship a bunch of rubber duckies over to, like, it was like a bad joke, but it was like poor and it was kind of at the beginning of like everybody being ultimately offended.
PC.
He's old school comedian.
He might even be the Janet Jackson, to use that analogy. He might be the marker of like when people started to shift,
especially on Twitter.
On social media, nobody ever brings him up, but he might be the guy,
because it was like 2007 six or something. I have to look it up, but
and I remember thinking, well, that's not that bad. I mean, like, that's Gilbert Gottfried. He's known to be like
kind of sarcastic in a humorous way.
I mean, Gilbert Gottfried, I mean,
on
like,
Stern,
if he was in
he
Howard
was
Stern,
just on oh yeah, yeah. I mean, just would murder
right.
people.
But you know why
I don't get, I'm sorry, but what I don't understand is why is there so much there's so much of a uproar about what comedians say when you can go on the internet and see some guy getting his head chopped off.
People like to touch that
for some reason. They like to touch, you know, celebrity, or they can, or somehow, you know, get them in their head. Yeah. You know, it's like, you know, whatever they're going off.
You know, it's a weird psychology too, though, because I think if he would have said that on Howard Stern or said it on the radio, whatever, probably wouldn't. No. Have, the fact that it was in type
when it's written,
then you can't even see the inflection or what. Yeah. If Gilbert Gottfried was saying it, you'd probably be like, oh, it's fucking Gilbert Gottfried.
Right.
But because it's in text, everybody's like, oh my God.
It sounds like we should just go send them rubber duckies.
And then, so anyway, back to my voiceover thing. So when he got fired, then he was like, Gilbert Gottfried loses his contract with Affleck, worth $1 million, whatever. You're like, whoa, you got one? God. He was like, it's $1 million, just him screaming Affleck. Like, how many times did
Wait. What was he doing, really?
He was doing
his voice screaming a word.
Yeah, and then
it wasn't like he was like doing the most perfect representation of a duck.
So he was being him, which is great. Pablo, like, that leads me to: is there any still like the pun intended, the golden goose of like voiceover jobs? Like, because we talk about Bruce Buffer, the Let's Get Ready to Rumble guy.
Okay. Oh yeah.
I'm so mad that
did you really just say Let's Get Ready to Rumble?
Elmer Fudd.
Let's get ready to wumble. You know what? I thought to myself, let it go, because he's got a point here. But then you were like, you know, it's just like the Let's Get Ready to Wumble guy. You know, no, I can't fucking wumble. Take that seriously.
He's talking to babies.
I'm sorry.
He's so cute, isn't he?
But he's made like $200 million
it's insane.
He licensed that and he's like, no one else can say it. And then the amount of money he would make just to get on, like, announce the boxers, say Let's Get Ready to Rumble, it was absurd. Like, way more.
His
like
brother
was
wow.
well overpaid
too.
So are there any gigs like that that someone has, like this voiceover gig that they don't have to do much work and they're getting just ridiculous amounts of money?
You
or
know
no?
what that I think you just said it right there. Let's Get Ready to Rumble is a biggest one I've ever heard in my life. Let's Get Ready to Rumble.
Anybody can you could, Pablo, you could easily do. You probably took half the money. You're like, I'll take 100 instead of 200 million, and I'll do it every single time.
No, I say fumble. It gets ready to rumble. Fumble. I change it around.
What is his brother's catchphrase? Is it like, it's go time?
It's go time.
Oh yeah, that's another one.
And they both have like these things. And even though his brother is probably making not even a half of what he makes, he's still like
too much.
$50 million or something ridiculous. Like Bruce Buffer's worth like $1 billion.
You're battle rapping some, like, you're doing combined, like, in one battle rap, more work than they've ever done.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like,
you're doing research, you're making sure your rhymes are tight.
Remembering
just,
it.
You're on camera, you have to look good, you know. Yeah.
You gotta copyright, that's what I do, well, that's me.
They don't even remember the boxers' names, they have a card. They don't even take the time, like, okay, I'm getting paid $1 million for 5 minutes in the ring, I'm not even gonna bother remembering everybody's stats, I have a fucking card, so just read.
Ready to
rumble.
No, but
Bruce
my
Buffer.
Favorite ones, and I've seen these, my favorite ones are the ones where they're not even announcing the boxers. They just come out, address the crowd, say like, Caesar's Palace, whatever.
Oh, that's cheaper.
Then they say, let's get ready to rumble. Then they exit, and then another guy comes in and reads the boxer. So I'm like, you didn't even fucking do anything.
Yeah, yeah.
Would you even pay that guy? Don't even pay him. Just let him complain a little bit. You know? Come on.
Give him exposure.
Okay.
So there probably isn't really the huge, like, you know, voiceover gig that every voiceover guy's looking at like that motherfucker.
Who's going to take his job after? Like
Bruce Buffer or Michael Buffer? It's Bruce.
Bruce,
right?
Buffer is the
Michael is his.
But the thing is, how he could do this for another 20 years? Fine, like you could old Bruce Buffer
audition it. Ready to Rumble.
I mean, he had a movie and he made money on that because Ready to Rumble, the movie, was his. Wow. He had the video game. Let's get ready to rumble boxing or whatever.
Oh,
it was
wow.
He's had merchandise.
He gets women.
I mean, so when you think about it, they're
getting hoes.
He'll probably just pass it on to somebody. You know, like his son. He'd
be so mad if his son,
Billy
Buffer. Give it to some foreign guy. We're ready to rumble. Come on, guy.
Believe me, you could not say that in any fight or you'll be sued like crazy.
I was talking about an alcoholic drink called Rumble.
Rumble. Get ready to drink Rumble.
So Bruce Buffer worth $120 million.
Just for that.
He's just made that by licensing and copywriting, Let's Get Ready to Rumble, and then just announcing box. That's the most overpaid person in the world.
Wow.
Right? Like, there's no one more overpaid than that.
Yeah.
As far as talent goes with like what you're getting paid, that's insane. Like,
what did
they
paid you?
I was at
he
a
just
radio.
Says, Let's Get Ready to Rumble. What's
no, ready like, to
what
Rumble.
Oh, yeah. He just, massage, lives a rich life, then shows up at a boxing match every once in a while. Like, doesn't remember the name.
That is
reads
the
on the card.
Do you remember? You got mail. I met that guy. He was a cameraman at a news station. He goes, I'm the one who does that voice. You got mail. And they paid him,
really?
They paid him, $15. That's it.
Yeah.
So he got kind of ripped off on that one. Yep.
Oh, that guy got fucked, man.
He got screwed up.
Yeah, well, yeah, big companies.
He was in a movie?
Yeah. He had a whole movie
you
about it. With Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah,
it's a great movie.
Because if you think about it, like...
I love that movie. I love me some Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan. Oh, my God, the chemistry.
Yeah.
Because AOL's before, like...
It makes me want to love my wife.
Every once in a while...
You got laid.
Yeah. Where, at the time, I'm sure this guy's like, I don't know what the hell the internet or email is. And then someone's like, hey, can you record just you saying you got mail? And he's like, all right, you got mail. $15 for this. He probably thought he was scamming them at the time.
Yeah, sure, I'll take it. You got mail.
Our Twitch chat room, twitch.tv/TomandDanLive, brings up Vanna White.
Ouch. Oh, yeah, that's an easy job.
Yeah, because she doesn't even talk except like the banter with Pat Sajak at the end. She'll just be like, he'll be like, I'm really enjoying myself here in Seattle. And she's like, it is. It's nice. It's not as rainy as people say.
Not worth $120. You know,
what do you think Vanna White's worth?
I bet she's like $15 million.
She looks really good too.
Yeah, she's hot. She's
like when you look at her,
I think she's
in her 60s. I could be wrong.
She gets paid a lot of money.
Maybe
50s.
Probably late 60s.
I think she looks great.
Okay, Vanna White. Anybody want?
Did you put Alex Yu to work?
Whoa! All right, this will make you mad too. Guess what, Vanna White?
Did you just shit your pants?
For now, she doesn't even have to turn the thing. She pushes a button. By the way, because they changed it.
I think actually it's motion activated now. I think she can just wave her hand.
No, okay.
She stays clean. I'm serious.
Yeah.
It's like Surrey.
This is gonna make everybody mad.
She can be like, "Hey, tile, switch." You know, like so everything is automated. Like,
now Vanna White's had a long career, but
I also think
just
she's gorgeous,
career.
And I bought the issue with her in Playboy. Yeah.
There you go, kid.
She was in Playboy.
Mm-hmm.
You can find her noob.
I'm also sure Vanna White had to put up with a lot prior to Me
sexual,
Too movement.
Oh my God, that poor woman.
She was sexually harassed.
Everybody's like. Give me a D. I
like to buy a vowel.
Because when did Wheel of Fortune start? 80s, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, prime.
It was
prime
Chuck Woolery.
She's totally seen.
She's seen hundreds of guys jack off on planes. Yeah. Like, for sure.
She's
but she powered
and her last
through
name.
A-E-I-O-U.
Yeah.
Wow, man, F-E.
So yeah. Vanna White is worth $50 million.
What?
Yep, $50 million.
Million yeah,
make us all feel bad.
You know what? Let's go to commercial.
You know what I really like about her and Pat is the fact that, and I don't watch the show. Occasionally, I'll catch it when it's on, and when I do, they're always doing something. They're always like, "We're in Paris," and you know all that shit. Like, she gets paid. Okay, don't get me wrong. Yeah. But you know she gets a per diem. You know she gets an awesome hotel.
She's
not,
right.
It's not coming out of her payment.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah,
she's
yeah.
getting comped.
That's in her contract.
They're sending her all across the fucking globe just to turn letters for dumb phrases.
Yeah.
Who did she know? Who did she know?
I think she just
I think she just auditioned and happened to be a cute blonde, and then she just like said, "Well, if I maintain my body,
I'm gonna keep my head
face
down.
And I'm gonna look literally not. I'm not gonna make any waves. I'm just gonna
report the atrocities people.
She jumped on the producer.
I'm gonna wash the semen out of all these plants. I'll water them to keep them from dying.
And
I'm head down, and I'm gonna secretly become one of the most paid women that does literally the easiest job in the world. I don't want to say she does nothing because. Just being her probably comes with a certain stigma or something
you probably
hard.
Can't
you know?
Go,
I don't know her reality, so I don't want to say that.
She does
a
lot of appearances, too.
Oh, I'm sure.
She's probably sleeping in a hotel and you're like, A-E-I-O-U,
you've got the job.
It's crazy, though, the difference that you see. Like someone like Vanna White, and then like Pablo, I'm sure you see these comedians that have been working for like 30 years and like 40 years and just on the road continually and like just busting their ass and stuff and like and making it, but just I mean the amount of work that some people
just to
do
travel.
And,
I mean is that the hardest part of what you guys do, right?
My travel. I just bumped myself up to a first class because you have the frequent flyer miles and stuff like that, and the club pays for most of it. So it's for me. It's I have no problem with it. It's good.
Yeah,
it's all good.
First class is pretty dope, man.
Yeah.
As a person that doesn't like to fly.
Oh right. Okay. Yeah.
I bump myself up as much as I can, but I don't bump my wife up.
Right?
I seriously don't.
To save the money.
To save the money. I'm not an asshole. I would, but she's like, no, I'll sit back here. And we're okay being alone.
You know, she's cool.
And I sit up front and I eat my fettuccine alfredo and a fresh baked roll and a side salad.
Right.
And then I have them pull the curtain on her. But I do love me some first class. Way better.
And then you got the United Arab Emirates first. Like their first class. Like with
if you see a tiny hat, you know you get an awesome.
Have any of you guys ever done like the ultra luxurious extravagant like first class with the shit you have your own pod and
like
your dining table.
Somewhere like that, yeah. On
you
the
got
way
like
to...
a computer desk,
yeah.
With a little TV, and then you get a bed, and then you can change the ambient lighting,
right? The dome, mine was on the way to Jordan. One of these guys, the guy told me to come on first class, open up the champagne kind of thing. Little bunk bed, Bobby and
Have you been
Peter.
To the Seychelles?
What's that?
The Seychelles Islands. Have you either?
No, I've not been there.
Yeah, that's the one that Tom and I are obsessed with. The sheik.
There's a sheik that flies comedians in there, and for them to do personal stand up for his harem. Right. It's bizarre. Yeah. Like Lunel, Guy Tori been out there.
Guy
a couple
Tory's
of other
couple
comedians
times.
That have come in here, and we talked to him. And it's like, and it's a fat paycheck, and you go out there do one show for just all women, and all the men are gay.
Are like gay staff
because he doesn't want any straight men around his harem of women. It is like it's as close to Game of Thrones being a king as like, and again, this guy is just some like sheik, like some
the
like
prince.
Relative.
Our
or
dream
something.
Is to go and broadcast with the prince.
That might happen.
It sounds sort of dangerous, like. I don't want to get caught accidentally looking or something, and next thing you know, I'm missing my hands. I do want to go, and I do want to respect his rules. Look, it's your islands, whatever, man.
You just got to act gay.
It's pretty easy for me.
There you go, man.
Like, look at me. It's like, look at this guy. Look at his
good luck
shorts.
On that. That would be great.
His shorts are too small.
Right on, man.
Yeah, there's no way he's going to like girls.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, come on down to the show if anybody wants to come down and see Pablito.
Yes.
At the
Orlando Improv, and it's a good place to take a date because the lights go down.
Yep.
Yeah,
and
it's
nice. We do all the talking and the lights go down, so we'll just do all the talking and hit BB Kings if you want. But this is a big sheik, huh? This little sheik.
It's weird. It's weird. But two shows tonight, two shows tomorrow, one show on Sunday.
Yeah, please
go to Improv Orlando.
Tell them that Tom and Dan sent you. Wear your gear. If you haven't seen Pablo, you're definitely in for a treat. Get your tickets now.
Yep.
TheImprovOrlando.com.
Yep. Guys, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
And my verse, where people can find you on social media.
Yeah, my verse. My verse, one word, capital V. Look me up. Yeah, you're going to see me on Wildin' Out. They haven't aired. I did 9 episodes last season, so they haven't aired those yet.
Gotcha, okay.
And so, because I guess Viacom and like DirecTV, AT&T, they were having like this.
Yeah,
they were just having negotiations, and so now everything's, you know, they got a new contract for another 90 more episodes.
God, so 90 more. No, 90. They ordered a lot.
So I'm hopefully I get like
sitcoms
eight,
are
hoping
for 10, and you're like, we on 90. You're like, all right, I'll be
final
working for a
like
while.
Game of Thrones, like 6 episodes.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping to get 89 of those.
Awesome.
So,
awesome.
Yeah. Well, my verse. One word.
We'll be watching you. And Pablo, where can people find you?
PabloFrancisco.com, YouTube, all that good stuff. Just check me out. You'll have fun. You're being good handled at all, Steve.
Awesome. Awesome. Guys, we will see you on the Friday Free Show.